G'day and welcome back to RC Model Reviews. Today I'm going to talk about this, the F-Zones. And why am I calling it the F-Zones? Because it's a bit of a debate as to whether it's Fresnel, whatever. But it's named after the guy that discovered and worked all the stuff out, Charles de Gaulle. He's a famous French president. No, hang on a minute, it wasn't him, someone else. Oh, it's Guy Fresnel or Fresnel or whatever his name is. So I'm going to call it the F-Zone because it's easier and then people won't complain so much when I use Fresnel or Fresnel or whatever. So just there you go. The F-Zones are what we're talking about. Notice zones, not zona, because there's more than one. In fact, there's an infinite number of these damn things. And I'm going to talk about the way they affect our radio transmissions. That's important because we're using radio for our radio control link, our telemetry link back, and also our video link, our FPV video link. So we need to know how this F or these F zones affect our transmissions and what we can expect and how to try and mitigate the problems that they can cause. So let's get on with it. Let's talk about what I've got on the board here. Now I have on the board, excuse me while I hunt for pens because I'm always losing them. I've got a radio transmitter here, which is TX. Got a receiver over here, RX. And you know, when I bought this whiteboard, they gave me these little magnetic pink things. I thought, what am I going to use those for? But finally, I found a use for them. Isn't that great? Wonderful. So here we go. We've got a transmitter and a receiver. So the signal goes as you'd expect. This is the direct wave, as we call it, the direct signal between the transmitter and receiver. So providing there's nothing blocking it, then the direct wave goes straight from the transmitter to the receiver, as you would expect. And of course, the further away you get, the weaker the signal is. Because one thing to remember is that all transmitters, even with a directional antenna, are actually spewing signals out in all directions. Okay, they're stronger in some directions than others, but they do radiate in a kind of a circular, or sort of a randomly circular pattern. Even with a helical or a Yagi beam or whatever, you're still going to get some back transmissions. And here we're looking at, if you have a radio control transmitter, it broadcasts everywhere because you want an omnidirectional pattern so you don't have to worry about pointing your transmitter in the right direction. And in the case of an FPV transmitter, same thing, it's transmitting in all directions because depending on which way the model's facing, you don't want to lose your signal if it's directional. There you go. So omnidirectional transmitters are the norm in our hobby. Right, so there we go, omnidirectional transmitter, transmitting in all directions, receiver. Now you can use a high gain antenna on your receiver, doesn't matter. For the purposes of this, discussing the F-zones, that's not going to matter one jot. So I've drawn some lines here, and I've got, I've got a purple line, which I shall annotate now. The purple line is zone number one. And there is an orange line, which is, can you guess? Zone number two. There we go. And so there are even zones and odd zones. And it's important because they do two different things happen when these zones are impinged on. That's a big word. Look it up if you don't know what it means. So here we go. Let's just assume we're in free space. We've got our transmitter on a planet over this part of the galaxy. We've got a receiver on a planet this side of the galaxy. Bing, bing. All works as you'd expect. The signal arrives. Great. The further away you go, the weaker it gets. Everything seems pretty damn normal. But let's introduce something. Let's say we're actually flying FPV and we're flying along and there's the ground to contend with. Let's draw the ground in here. I'll just draw a little bit of ground in here. There you go. There's the ground. A little bit, and there might be trees and shrubs and things. And you notice I've drawn the ground. It actually impinges on this zone one because it's either side. This is like a completely three-dimensional thing. It's like a giant cucumber that's been squeezed at the ends. So the signal, so the ground is impinging on these zones. Now, what happens then is something really interesting. Because our transmitter is transmitting in all directions at once, some of the transmitter's signal, get my pens in the right order here, some of the signal is actually going to be going this way, and it's going to bounce off the ground because that's what happens. A lot of it's absorbed, but some of it's bounced off. And when it's bounced off, we'll say it changes color, so we know, and it comes. You like the noises? All the way back to our receiver. So now we've got two paths. Our signal's taking two paths to get to the receiver, the direct path and the reflected path. And we all know, we've heard about multipathing. Well, this is multipathing because there's now more than one path. And in fact, there's actually other paths as well because anything within that zone creates, there could be a path here and it bounces over here. So then it reflects off there. So all these paths are combining to affect the signal that the receiver sees. And the interesting thing is that if you're inside, or if it's bouncing off something inside this number one zone, then all these, or most of these reflections here are actually going to attenuate. They're going to reduce the level of signal your receiver sees. Why is that? Well, that's quite simple. Because they change the amount of time it takes for this signal to reach that versus the direct signal is obviously longer. And if we look at what a wave is, I'm going to draw a little diagram of a wave. Here's a wave. I'll draw a little graph here so we know what things are. This is time, and this is plus and minus of amplitude. So let's do a wave. Here is a direct wave. Here it is. And it goes like this. It goes, ooh, there you go. That's our direct wave. Simple, piece of cake. Now I'm going to extend this a little bit further here. Let's go back this way. Oh. So this, we're just looking at a part of it. Obviously, this wave goes really long because radio transmission's gone for a long time a lot of the time. So there we go. There's our original wave. We're looking at this little piece here. That's the important piece. Now, so when it arrives at the receiver sees this. Now, what about this reflected wave? If it's inside zone one, it's going to arrive, it's going to be delayed. So instead of starting here, it's going to start, well, what we're going to do is take that same wave, we're going to shift it a bit. So it's going to be the same shape, but it's going to be out by 180 degrees. And I'll just draw in the degrees here. So, whoops, ooh, juggling pens, it's great fun. This is, if we do this, this is 0 degrees, and that's 360 degrees. And here's 180 degrees. So that's the phases, that's the phase of the wave. It starts at zero, goes to up to 90, down to, was it 90? 45, down to 90, down to, I don't know, yeah, work it out yourselves. So this is the phase of the wave. When this reflected wave comes, if it's in zone, if it bounces off something inside zone one, then it's delayed by half a wavelength. So the wave will actually look half a wavelength behind. So in fact, it'll be looking a bit like this. So you can see it's half a wavelength behind. And what that means is if we were to take all the blue areas here, if we take the blue, here we go. There's the blue and the blue. And we were to add it to the red, which is here. That actually cancel out. There's as much above the line as below the line. So what the receiver would see is a big fat nothing. Straight line at zero. Because these two waves now cancel out. They're anti-phase, they're out of phase, they're cancelling out. Every time this one goes up, that one goes down. So it basically nullifies the direct signal. So what happens is if you have anything inside this number one zone, the signals that are reflected end up producing a signal that is half a wavelength behind because it's had to travel half a wavelength further, and therefore you get bugger all signal on your receiver. And that's why the signal fades out. Because, you know, if you're watching the FPV glasses, you'll find it'll go all snowy. But if you carry on, go a bit further, it comes right. How the hell does that work? I'll tell you in a moment. But let's have another look here. Let's take away the ground. Let's move the ground out of here. Don't want the ground here anymore, because what I'm going to do is get rid of these. I'm going to show you what zone 2 does. Got zone 2 in here. Zone 2 is our friend. I'll put these lines back here. What do you got? Purple. Thank you, the person that sent me these markers. It's improved my juggling skills no end. Here we go. Here is the zone 1 back. I'm now going to put the ground down here in zone 2. Here we go. Zone 2. Now this is really interesting because what happens with zone 2, and you probably already guessed it, some of you, is we've still got this indirect signal from our transmitter, and it hits this thing in zone 2 and bounces off, but this time it's coming off like so. And the total distance here is one wavelength more than the direct route. So our wave here has shifted another half a wavelength. So actually what we end up with is, remember the blue is our original one, we end up with another green wave like this, which is actually exactly the same as the blue wave. And that means they add together. So the resulting signal that the receiver sees is, let me draw it with a purple pen, it's twice that. So it's actually, I'll draw it on here, it's actually this wave. So you can see that the strength of the signal is hugely increased because those two waves have added together to double the strength of the signal being seen, because this is now an entire whole wavelength behind. So if you have an obstruction that's in the, or a reflective surface in the second zone, it will boost your signal. Woohoo! Win. But if it's in the second zone in the first zone, it'll still be bouncing off the first zone, so then you lose it. So sometimes that also explains why you're flying along, you get a fairly weak signal, and suddenly the RSSI improves or the video signal improves, even though you've gone further away. It's because you've moved into the second zone. I'm going to show you how these zones change as you're moving along, as your model's flying further away now. Okay, excuse me if the color and everything's different, but I just recorded this whole section without turning on the microphone. I hate it when that happens, but it happens sometimes. I'll get over it. Right, what I want to look at now is what happens to our models as we're, you know, changing the distance and the altitude. How does that affect the way the F zones are going to affect our signal? Well, as most people know, if you've got the model with FPV on it, you're flying away, it's all cool and groovy and happiness, and then all of a sudden it starts to get a bit snowy, and then it might come right again because you've just violated the F zone, one of the odd numbered F zones, and that has produced an attenuation, a loss of signal due to that phase thing we talked about earlier, the reflected signal cancelling out the direct signal. So what's going to happen? Well, first of all, we need to do some maths. Yes, I know you've all been waiting for this part of it, and this is the bit everyone loves, the maths part. And here's a formula that enables us to work out what the size of our F zone based on the distance of the direct path and the indirect path and the wavelength and so forth, the multiples of wavelength and so forth. So I'm not going to go through this with you because there's a much simpler way to do it. We can do a bit of pre-calculation, introduce a constant, and we get this formula here, which most people can probably cope with. And R, that is the height or the radius of our F zone, the one that's going to cause problems, the first F zone. And then this is a constant. Then D is the distance between our transmitter and our receiver, measured in kilometers. And F is the frequency we're using in gigahertz, because all these things make a difference. The distance, the frequency, distance and the frequency make a difference to the size of our F zone. So let's start off with the blue pen. And here are our transmitter and our receiver. And ta-da, we have put them 1 kilometer apart. So there we go, we can plug the numbers into this formula. Now we're going to run on 5.8 gigahertz, by the way, as well, just to make it simple, because that's what most people use for their FPV. So we're going to work on 5.8 gigahertz at 1 kilometer. There we go. So what size is our F zone going to be? That's this bit here, the first F zone. There we go. And we're going to measure the radius. This is R up here, R, because that's really the altitude that's going to be when the ground starts intersecting our F zone. So there we go. If we do the sums, we find that it's 3.6 meters is the 3.6 meters. That is the size of that. So it's 3.6 meters all around that center line of the direct signal. So if we were flying along, where's the ground? Let's put the ground in here. Okay, here we go. Here is the ground. Now, woohoo, we don't quite touch the ground here based on the height I'm flying. So let's say we're flying along. Let's say we've got our antenna on the here is mounted at 4 meters, and we've got our plane flying at 4 meters. Okay, we can fly out to 1 kilometer. No worries, because our radius, the size of our F zone there, isn't going to touch the ground. So woohoo, we're happy. Perfect sailing. Everything looks fine. Clear signal. You know, it might get a little bit grainier if we're using a very low power, but nothing dramatic. But what happens if we go out to 2 kilometers? Let's change some of the numbers here, and let's say we want to go 5.8 gigahertz at 2 kilometers equals what? What is our F zone going to look like now when we get out to 2 kilometers? Let's extend this line with the blue pen. Okay, now we've got 2 kilometers. What's happened to the F zone? Has it got bigger, smaller, whatever? Well, I did the sums and I lost the piece of paper. No, I didn't. Here it is. At 2 kilometers, our F zone is now, where did I put it? Oh, here we go. 5.08 meters. We've got 5 meters. So now we're at 5 meters. Woo! So suddenly R is 5 meters. Let's have a look here what this does. This R here, it's grown to 5 meters. So let's draw the new F zone. Oh, we've got a problem. We've got a problem. What's happened now is the ground is impinging on the F zone. What that means is we're going to get those reflected signals that we're talking about before. And I'll use my red pen. Yeah. So the direct signal, we're going to have this other signal which is going to bounce off the ground and come here antiphase to the original signal. It's going to cancel out. So we're going to fly. We're going to get that snowy effect. It's going to happen. Whoa, we're getting all snowy. What's going on here? That's not right. But that will only happen when this is actually sort of kind of touching there. I tend to find that when you go through the F zone, it'll get worse and it'll get better again because this is growing all the time. So it'll the phase of the wave that's reflected will change. So there's only a little point where suddenly, it gets really bad, then it'll get better again. But you've got to be aware that if you're flying out to 2 kilometres and you are 4 metres above the ground, then the F zone is going to be a real problem to you, a real problem indeed. So how are you going to get around that? How can you possibly deal with that? Well, it's pretty simple, isn't it? If you fly higher, let's put you up there. Let's draw the lines again so you can see. It's going to get pretty cluttered, but stick with me. There we go. There's our direct line. And let's draw our F zone, our 2 kilometer F zone. Oh, it misses the ground. So if you fly high enough, you fly above the F zone, or your F zone doesn't intersect with the ground, so you don't have a problem. The other thing you could do, of course, is, let's assume you're down there, is put your antenna, your receiver antenna, up a bit higher. Draw the lines again. This is getting to look like a patchwork quilt, isn't it? There we go. And now, if we draw the F zone, it still misses the ground, so you're still good. So altitude of both your transmitter, your aircraft, and your receiver antenna are both critical to when the F zone kicks in, when you're going to have this problem. The higher, the better. If you fly high enough, you probably never encounter the F zone. If you're flying low, it becomes far more important. I notice when I'm flying mini quads a lot, if I'm sitting there in a chair and I've got my goggles on and I'm flying out and I'm only a few meters away, I can really feel when I go through F zone points where the signal is now coming anti-phase. You really notice it dropping off, and then it comes good again, then it drops off, comes good. So key things, altitude. But of course, remember, models, legally, most countries were limited. And even in the USA, there is that advisory circular that recommends you don't fly above 400 feet. And if you've registered your drone, well, you've entered a civil contract which says you won't fly above 400 feet. So whether it's the law or not, the FAA could sue you because you've broken the contract if they find you flying above 400 feet. Anyway, so there you go. The altitude you can fly at can limit your operations quite a bit because even at 400 feet, the F zone will kick in at a distance, but then you'll be beyond visual line of sight anyway. So again, breaking the law in most countries. So the F zone, a lot of noise is made about it. If you're flying within visual line of sight, you still see the model, and using something like a 200 milliwatt transmitter really doesn't matter very much. You're still going to get pretty good reception. It's not going to kill your FPV experience. But something else we should look at, of course, is the effective frequency. Now, these are the figures for 5.8 gigahertz. I'll just do them again here. 5.8, let's assume a distance of 1 kilometer, 5.8 gigahertz. Then we've got a F zone size of 3.6 meters. What if we go down to 2.4 gigahertz? I did work that out earlier, 2.4 gigahertz. Now, if we look at the formula, the frequency is on the bottom here. So the higher the frequency, then the smaller the number. And we're going down in frequency, so we expect this number to get bigger. And so what did I work out for 2.4? It is 5.6 meters. And if we go down to 1.2 gigahertz, which is common for long range FPV, that number blows out to, where did I put it? Can't read my own writing. 7.7 meters. There we go, 7.7 meters. So you can see as you're going down in frequency, the F zone becomes more of a factor because, this radius of the zone is getting bigger and bigger because it's function of this, it's an element of that function up there. So if you go down to UHF, I haven't done, this is something for you to try at home. Now get your calculators, get your crayons out, sharpen them up. What is it for 0.433 megahertz, which is a commonly used frequency for radio control, long range radio control? Work that out yourselves and see what you think. I'm picking, it's about a third that, so it's probably going to be about 20 meters or something like that. I don't know, work it out. Somewhere around there. So it gets bigger and bigger and bigger as you go down a frequency. So all I can say is if you want to fly FPV, and you can stick with 5.8 gigahertz, stay, above 4 or 5 meters within a kilometer or so, and you should be good. But remember, if you're sitting down, it's going to be worse because your receiver antenna, if you've got your goggles on, a little antenna, you're sitting right close to the ground. That's going to mean that the F zone will kick in quite early on because it's going to tilt that thing, and the bottom end where you're sitting is going to intersect with the ground, even though the F zone size is only 3.6 meters. Hope that's helped you out. Hope it hasn't confused the snot out of you like it does for me. Some people are going to complain, say, oh, that's not right. It's not exactly right. You've made a mistake there. Well, yeah, As I always say, I try to simplify stuff so it's more understandable. I take a few liberties, but hey, you know, it's all in the name of giving you people the information you need without boring the pants off you, which I hope I haven't done, and without using too much of this math stuff. But there you go. So there you go. F zone, not a big thing for most people, not a big thing at all. In fact, I don't think it's going to affect anyone's experience if you're flying within the rules. And remember, we've got to fly within the rules, because otherwise you get locked up and they take all your stuff and sort of fine you huge amounts of money. So you can have a lot of fun flying within the rules. Mini quads, even just flying FPV around your local field, you know, there's a lot of things you can do. FPV combat, I'll be doing some more on that later. But there you go, that's it, that's the bottom line. If you've got questions, if you've got comments, anything you want to know, anything that you think I might have glossed over, then please put them in the usual place. I'll do my best to address them. In the meantime, it's late, it's raining today, damn it all, middle of summer and it's raining. Oh, I've got to get back to the bench. Bye for now.